Good morning, all you faithful people of God. The Lord be with you and also with you. We listen to the hymn, The Servant King. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. When America began the Apollo project to put a man on the moon, their motivations were not entirely scientific. In fact, the so-called space race was driven by the ego of the Americans. The Soviet Union was the first to launch a satellite into space. They were the first to put a living creature, a monkey, into space. And Yuri Gagarin, a Soviet cosmonaut, is listed as the first man in space. So America's bid to put a man on the moon was nothing more than a response to a string of humiliating second place finishes to the Soviet Union's space programs. So it was with great pride that Americans watched and listened on the 20th of July 1969 as Neil Armstrong stepped out of the lunar module and uttered those famous words, "That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind." He became the first man to walk on the surface of the moon, so America was first again. There is something in our human nature that craves for being first. There is no glory in being second or third. Even in Christianity, we see this craving for first place. Jesus and his disciples were going to the town of Capernaum. As they entered the house where they would be staying, Jesus asked his disciples, "What were you arguing about on the road?" But they kept quiet because on the way they had argued about who was the greatest among them. The disciples were human, just like us. Who doesn't want to stand out and be great? Some of the greatest people who have ever lived were also among the most ambitious. It is said that Michelangelo prayed, "Lord, grant that I may always desire more than I can accomplish." Abraham Lincoln often said to himself as a boy studying at night near the fireplace, "I will study and get ready, and perhaps my chance will come." And indeed, it did come when he became the 16th president of the United States of America. The lust for greatness is the original sin. It was a promise of the serpent to Eve. "For God knows then that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." It is the lust for power and greatness that starts wars, destroys nations, turns people and religious groups against each other, and today continues to cause untold death and human suffering with women and children, the poor and vulnerable, always experiencing the brunt of the violence. This lust for power is now so embedded in our culture and political structures and social systems that it has become a part of the very fabric of our existence. Yet it begins right here in the human heart with our fundamental human desire to be the greatest. The disciples wanted to be the greatest. There is nothing wrong with that, as long as it does not cause us to mistreat others or betray our values and principles. In Shakespeare's play, Twelfth Night, Malvolio said, "Some are born great, some achieve greatness, and some have greatness thrust upon them." But true greatness is neither born in you, nor achieved by you or imposed upon you. Instead, it is the byproduct of the deeper qualities of our human nature. Our greatness is revealed in our service and care of others. In Paris, there are two statues of two men, both named Louis. The first is of Louis XIV, France's absolute monarch, who is remembered today chiefly for his words, I quote, "I am the state," unquote. His philosophy of life was that the whole nation and the world should serve him. A few blocks away is a less pretentious statue. There is no uniform on this figure carved in stone, no badge of office, no sword, no crown. It is a memorial to Louis Pasteur, the servant of humanity and the servant of God. His research in chemistry led to remarkable breakthroughs in the understanding of the causes and preventions of diseases, which laid down the foundations of hygiene, public health, vaccinations, and much more of modern medicine. His works are credited to saving millions of lives. It is this uncrowned servant of humanity who wears the real crown of greatness, of people's love and honor. Serving others isn't an option for Christians. It is a requirement. This world puts a lot of emphasis on power, money, looks, and possessions. But in God's kingdom, only one thing matters: how much you're willing to do for others. We live in a consumer-oriented society. But to be a follower of Jesus Christ requires a totally different attitude. It requires an attitude of giving rather than receiving. It requires serving rather than being served. Being the greatest does not mean being number one. It means serving others in the name of Jesus Christ. Greatness never puts itself in a position of superiority over another. It is not about me, my nation, my tribe, my people, my religion, my politics, my accomplishments, my reputation, and my status. Jesus is trying to teach the disciples an object lesson about greatness, about servanthood, about leadership. Jesus gives us a picture of being a servant. Then Jesus put a child among them. Taking the child in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever receives one of these children in my name receives me, and whoever receives me receives not me, but him who sent me." In Aramaic, the word for child and servant is the same. Children were the least significant people in their world. If you want to be great, seek to be like a child, one without rank, position, or privilege. The way people view the church today is a strong indicator that we have not moved far from the disciples' understanding of serving others. A man asked an old rabbi, "The scriptures reveal that in the old days people saw God. Why can't we see God today?" And the wise rabbi answered, "Because today no one can stoop low enough." If you want to be great in the eyes of God, serve others instead of yourself. Be inclusive, not exclusive of his followers. Allow others into your circle. To be effective in ministry, we need to learn one thing. Don't take yourself too seriously. Don't be too bothered about how people see you or treat you. Get over yourself. Don't get stuck inside your own ego, because in time, it will become your prison. Get over yourself and start giving of yourself. When we focus on ourselves, there will be arguments and debates. Debates come because we are too focused on self, my ideas, my ways, my methods. Today's gospel started with the disciples arguing with one another. And Jesus ends his teaching with these words: "Have salt in yourselves and be at peace with each other." When we overcome fear, when we tear down the walls and make room for one who is different, vulnerable, and in need, then we are the greatest. Dr. Viktor Frankl was imprisoned in one of Hitler's death camps. The Jewish people suffered unbelievable atrocities. Everything about their living and working conditions were deplorable, including their medical care. Dr. Viktor Frankl offered what little medical help he could to the sick and dying. Over time, he discovered a unique phenomenon that he recorded in his book entitled Man's Search for Meaning. He said, "Those people who kept their strength and sanity the longest were those who tried to help other prisoners and shared what little they had. Their physical and mental condition seemed strengthened by their friendliness, compassion, and focus on something other than themselves." Christian ministry energizes us, contrary to the great fear that our resources will be depleted if we help others. Jesus came among us as a servant. He came to touch, to embrace, to heal, to forgive, to help, to love, even when he knew it would take him to the cross. The great author Rick Warren notes the mark of spiritual maturity that occurs when a believer takes off the bib and puts on an apron. Immature children wear bibs and expect others to meet their needs. Those who put on aprons have learned the joy of serving others. The question is, are you wearing a bib, or are you wearing an apron? May God help us to serve others. Amen. We listen to the hymn, "Jesu, Jesu, fill us with your love." Our spiritual communion as we pray. Soul of Christ, sanctify me. Body of Christ, save me. Blood of Christ, refresh me. Water from the side of Christ, strengthen me. O good Jesus, hear me. Within your wounds, hide me. Let me never be separated from you. From the malicious enemy, defend me. In the hour of my death, call me and bid me come to you, that with your saints I may praise you forever and ever. Amen. The blessing. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God, and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen. The dismissal. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ. Amen. We listen to our closing hymn. Brother, sister, let me serve you.